Hello friends, this is Himanshu from Code Campaign, and today we are going to discuss about space complexity analysis of algorithm. So what is space complexity? The space complexity of an algorithm determines how much time, how much memory our algorithm is going to take while we are going to run it. So first of all, let's discuss about the memory. As we all use desktop, laptops, so we already know there is RAM on our laptop, desktop, and there is other memory which is ROM. So what is primary memory? So primary memory is basically a RAM, and RAM is the memory on which our programs run. While our programs are running, they declare variables, they allocate objects, and all those objects which they allocate are going to reside on the heap and the stack, and the heap and stack are being allocated in our primary memory, which is RAM. Okay. And what is secondary memory? Secondary memory, we already know. Secondary memory is the hard disk associated with our laptop and desktop. And secondary memory could be external device, like whatever external hard disk we have, it could be a pen drive. And the difference between the primary memory and the secondary memory is the primary memory is volatile. Like suppose you're writing a document, suppose you're writing a Word document, and suddenly your laptop crashes. So that work, whatever you were doing, will not be saved. So all the work will be lost. And why that work will be lost? Because that work was while you were typing or writing it, until you saved it, it was in your RAM. And that is a volatile memory. So when the power will be lost, whatever data was there in the volatile memory will be erased. So to get that data transferred from the RAM to ROM or the primary memory to the secondary memory, what you have to do, you have to save the Word document, right? So it will go into the permanent storage, which is the secondary memory, which is ROM. So this is the basic difference between primary memory and the secondary memory. Okay, now let's discuss about the space complexity. So suppose we have this code. What this code does, it reverses, as the function suggests, it reverses a particular array. So suppose we are giving this array, it will return us the array which will be completely reversed. So let's take an example. So suppose we have this array as an input to this function. So what will be the output that we'll get? Will get something like this. So if you see, if this is the input and this is the output is reverse of the input. So this is what this function does. So what it is doing here, it is allocating an array which we are saying reverse array, and then it's allocating some variables, and then going through a for loop. Here what it is doing, this is array length. So suppose, so our array length is 5. So this will be 4, right? So this will be 4, and reverse index is 0. So what it is doing, it is taking the element on the fourth position and copying it at the zeroth location, and then it's increasing this index to here, and it's decreasing this index to here. Right, and then again it's doing the same thing, copying and then decreasing and then increasing and then copying again, right? So it's doing the same thing. So at the end of the program, we'll get this as the output. Okay, so this is what this program is doing. Now suppose we have to calculate the space complexity of this algorithm, like how much space it is going to take when we are going to run this program. Okay, let's erase this first. So suppose we want to calculate the space complexity of this algorithm. So let's suppose this is a 32-bit CPU, right? So what we are saying here, to declare any integer variable, we take 4 bytes. If you're not understanding this, just consider that for declaring any integer variable, we are taking only we are taking 4 bytes in the memory. Okay, so this is one integer variable. For this, how much memory will take? 4 byte, right? For this guy again, 4 byte, right? Apart from it, this is the logic. We are not declaring anything here. Here again, we are returning something, right? So, and then this is the array, right? So, in our previous example, which was something like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? So, what is the length of this array? We have 5 integers here, okay? And every integer take 4 bytes, so this will take 20 bytes, right? So, here what will happen? This will take 20 bytes, right? So, total space taken by this program to run will be 20 plus 4 plus 4, 28 bytes. This is the space to declare the variables, okay? Now, we can give any input here, right? We can give any input here. So, so suppose the length of the array is n, right? And we know every integer take 4 bytes. So the space taken by the array will be 4 into n, okay? Now, let's calculate the generic time complexity, where the length of this array is n, okay? So what will be the time complexity in this case? This will become 4n, right? So this will be 4n plus 4 and 4. So space complexity will become 4n plus 8, right? So this is our space complexity, 4n plus 8 for this algorithm, okay? Now you can see the space complexity of our algorithm depends upon the length of the array. So suppose the length of the array is very large, like suppose our array contains the million elements, then we need the memory, then we need the memory which can contain the million integers to run this program. Otherwise, this program will not run, okay? Okay, now let's see one optimized example, because now we know, okay, to run this program, we need the memory which is equal to the memory which is being occupied by the input. Like if our input array has million integers, we need at least the memory which can contain the million integers, right? So if we have the memory which cannot contain the million integers, this program will not run. So suppose we want to optimize this program so that we can run, we will be able to reverse the array even if we don't have the memory to store the million of the integers, right? So let's see the optimized version. Okay, so here you see the optimized version. What we are doing here? Declaring one start variable, declaring one end variable, and what we are doing here, we are taking one temp variable here. Okay, so let's take again the same example. 1, 3, 4, 5. So what we are doing here, our start is here, our end is here. Okay, then we have one temp variable and we are saying temp equal to array of start, right? So array of start is 1, so temp will contain 1. Then we are saying array of start equal to array of end, so we are saying copy this to here. Okay, so now this will contain 5, right? Now this will contain 5. Now on the other step, we are saying copy temp to array of end, so this will go here. So our array will become something like 5, 2, 3, 4, and 1. Okay. After this, what we are saying? Increment the start. So our start will come here and decrement the end. So our end will come here. Okay. Now again, we'll do the same operation. So temp will contain what? Temp will contain 2. This guy will go here. Okay. And temp will go here. So our array will again become something like 4, 2, and 1. Okay, then our start and end will come here, and what we are saying, our start should be less than end, so our this loop will end. So if you see this, we actually, our start array was This was our input and this is our output. So we actually reverse the array. But here if you see, we are not declaring any intermediate variable or intermediate array to hold the reverse of the array, right? So let's calculate the time complexity of this algorithm and see how it is actually optimized over the previous algorithm, okay? So I'm going to erase this now. So let's calculate the time complexity of the, again, we know for declaring a variable we need 4 bytes, so 4 byte here, 4 byte here, and we are declaring one variable here, so 4 byte here. Apart from it, there is nothing, right? So what is the space complexity for this algorithm? It's 12 bytes, right? So now if you see here, it is independent of the input length that we are passing, right? Right? We only need 12 bytes to allocate the variable to run this to run this program successfully, right? And in previous program, if we are passing the array which has the million elements, then we need the memory which can contain at least the million elements, right? Because we were declaring one array here, but in this program it is independent of the input array, right? So this is more optimized program because it needs less space. Okay, so that's how you will be able to, you know, you will be able to compare the algorithms by calculating its space complexity and will be able to know, okay, that algorithm will take more space and this algorithm will take less space. So this is better. Okay. Now let's move on. So again, as you guys have watched my previous lecture in which I explained you how to calculate the time complexity of the algorithm and what is Big O. Okay, so if you haven't watched, I will highly recommend go back and watch that video. So again, what is Big O? So Big O actually help us to calculate the worst case scenario, worst case complexity for a particular algorithm. It applies to both time complexity and both, and the other one is the space complexity. So it applies to both. So if I want to calculate the worst case space complexity, I will apply Big O again. So Big O is actually a notation which will give us the worst case scenario, because as a programmer we are always bothered about what will be the worst case scenario while running the algorithm, right? So again, what are the rules for calculating the Big O? Remove this time here, it could be space again. From a space equation, what we have to do, we have to take the term which increases with the high raised with respect to the input. And what we have to do again, the other step is remove all the coefficient which is multiplying the term. Okay, so we'll see it in the given upcoming example. So what was the space complexity we calculated for this guy? Was this, right? Okay, now let's again apply the Big O notation over it. So what is the term which is increasing with highest rate? This is the term, right? So we'll select this term. There are two terms and we'll select this term. So this is the term. And then the second rule suggests remove all the coefficients. So what is the coefficient here? This guy is the coefficient. So what will be the space complexity, Big O space complexity, O of n, right? And we can clearly see here that, you know, this integer array will be equal to the length of the array given, and if the array coming as an input has the n length, so this, I have to declare n length array here. So this will take n, this will take the space equal to n integers, right? So this is what this space complexity giving us. Okay, now calculate the same Big O complexity for the optimized algorithm. So what was the space complexity equation last time we calculated was 12 bytes, right? And it says take the term which is increasing with higher raise. We have only one term, so we have to select this. So we have this, and then what it says, the other second rule says remove all the coefficients it multiplied with. Now we have to only 12 here. So we can say 12 is multiplied with by 1, and then we can remove 12. So what will be the big O space complexity here? O1. So what O1 represent? Constant space. And which we already know, this irrespective of the input length, we are only declaring two variable here. So this is always constant, right? Or three variable we can say. So this is always constant irrespective of the input length. This is what this notation suggests. So that's how you can go ahead and calculate the space complexity of your algorithm and compare them, and you will be able to know like which algorithm is going to take more space. Okay, so let's move on. So I have already published three videos, and you know, after watching all the three videos, some guys will be losing the motivation. So again, I'm going to refresh your memory. What is the goal? So the goal is to crack interview any of these companies. And how we are going to do it? After going through all the basics, we are going to solve all the frequency hour questions in these software giants interviews, right? Okay, and let's see some motivation. So there are different kind of motivation for the people: the good work, the good salary, good perks, and the benefit that these companies are providing. So I've pulled out some graphs, some charts from the LinkedIn, and let's see how they look. So what is the average salary of a software developer in these kind of companies? So if you see for the Microsoft, if you have 6 to 14 years of experience, and this is old data, like this is not refreshed. Now the salaries have increased because, you know, every year the salaries will be increased by 10 to 20% due to inflation. And so this is the old data. Only 55 responses are being considered, and this is only the average, right? So if you see here, the salaries will vary from 20 to 39.7 lakhs, okay? And as you can see, like how much you are going to earn if you'll be able to crack the interview in any of these companies, right? And same as with Amazon, again, you see, goes up till 45 lakhs, right? So if you'll be able to crack the interview, you will be earning somewhere in the mid if you are average, and you can actually go ahead till this bar, which is quite huge amount, 45 lakhs. Okay, and then there are some companies like Uber which offer a lot, like for 4 to 5 years of experience, if you're SD2, your total compensation could go till here, like 45 lakhs or maybe more, you never know. Okay, so yeah, from the next videos, we will talk about the basic data structures, and then we'll start solving the problems that are being asked in these interviews. And if you haven't subscribed to my channel, please go ahead and subscribe, because I'm going to post more and more videos, and I hope that will help you in cracking these interviews. So thank you guys for watching this video. Goodbye.